Welcome to In Review, the show that brings you the biggest stories and expert interviews. This week we have had major changes in the UK and major developments in the world. We have the official resignation of David Cameron as Prime Minister of the UK, as well the installation, coronation of Theresa May as the new Prime Minister of the UK, the installation, I will say, of Boris Johnson as the new Foreign Secretary, terrible atrocities in Nice, terrible atrocities, of course, in Turkey. Earlier today, I spoke to Simon Woolley, who is the director of Operation Black Vote, where we look at some of the topical issues like the coronation of Theresa May as the new Prime Minister, the resignation of David Cameron, the appointment of Boris Johnson as the new Foreign Secretary. We looked at Nice, and most importantly, we talk about Black Lives Matters and as well Brexit and its impact. I've got Simon Woolley, who is one of our first guests on the In Review. Simon,
hi.
Welcome.
Pleasure to meet you.
Fantastic. Now, Simon is the prolific figure behind Operation Black Vote. And of course, what I want to do is to get his perspective on the latest big news in the UK, which we have the official resignation of David Cameron, the installation of a new Prime Minister, Theresa May, the appointment of Boris Johnson to Foreign Secretary, Brexit, and most importantly, Black Lives Matters. And Simon, one of the most important things we want to talk about is how can the Black Britain get involved and be at the table?
Sure, yes, right? Yes.
Now tell me, this week, your thoughts on this week?
Well, another monumental week. I mean, it's just a roller coaster for Britain, for Europe, and for the Black community here in the UK.
Yes.
And of course, that we thought it would be a leadership contest between two dynamic women. But even before the race started, one of them dropped out. And so we had the coronation of Theresa May.
Mm-hmm.
I've known Theresa May for nearly two decades now.
Yeah.
And particularly in the last 3 to 5 years.
Yes.
And I think one of the biggest factors that she has on her side is that fundamentally, I believe that she gets the issues of race equality.
Yes.
I think that particularly around issues of stop and search.
Yes.
I've seen her around those tables with senior police officers banging the table, demanding that they treat us with respect.
Yes.
And so the signs are good, not just on stop and search, but also on deaths in police custody and mental health.
Now, also, one of the things that people also say, she's cold-hearted, they don't see her smile, but your work through Operation Black Vote, what has been your interaction with her on a personal level?
Yes.
Like, put it this way, is she a friend of the Black community?
Well,
let's put it that way.
Well, I mean, she's a friend of democracy, and she understands many of the issues that we in the Black community face.
Yes.
My first interaction with her was about 15 or so years ago, when I sat down with her and Dominic Grieve and Francis Maude.
Yes.
I guess you'd describe them as grandees now.
Yes.
And the conversation was around the lack of Black representation in the Conservative Party and the Black community's antipathy towards even considering voting for the Conservatives.
Yes.
And she asked me, why? Why won't Black people vote for the Conservatives?
Yes.
And I told her, frankly, because they think you're a bunch of racists.
Yes.
Until you have a makeup that begins to look like the UK, and you have policies that are frankly perceived to be less racist, then Black people won't even consider you.
Yes.
And it was her and Maude and Greaves who helped begin the transformation of the Conservative Party, where they had no Black MPs. Now they have African, Asian and Caribbean, numbering about 12, I think.
So what you're saying now is that even though they're saying that the door was open, it wasn't inviting.
It was not only not invited, it was at times hostile.
Really?
And now I have to say that, of course, with all political parties, but particularly the Conservative Party, there's always an ebb and flow.
Yes.
Sometimes they're positive. Too often it's believed, it's seen to be negative.
Yes.
And so, of course, the austerity measures that David Cameron brought in disproportionately affected Black people.
Right.
In terms of employment, unemployment for young Black men, sky high, education, health. So we're saying now to a new Prime Minister who gets the race issues, who wants to change, we need to see a plan.
Okay.
A comprehensive plan.
Yes.
Right across Whitehall, in this fantastic building behind us, the mother of all parliaments.
Yes.
We want to see a roadmap that will, one, give us hope, and two, give us the opportunity, yeah. Silvan, to mm-hmm. fulfill our, what I believe, our great potential. Yeah.
Now, she mentioned something in her speech whereby that means fighting against the burning injustice that if you're born poor,
yep.
you'll die on average 9 years earlier than others. If you're black, yeah. you're treated more harshly by the criminal justice system. Is it that she's setting out her mandate by those key words on the Downing Street there last week?
I think those words are outside Downing Street was a yeah. statement of intent.
Yes.
So you set out some of these areas, the gross inequalities,
yes.
for no other reason than the colour of your skin,
yes.
or the gender that you have, or the working class area. Now for us,
yes.
we are disproportionately in that all those brackets.
Yes.
The gender penalty, the class penalty, mm-hmm. the race penalty.
Yes.
When you put all those three together, that equality is not served to us.
And then that brings us now to David Lammy.
Of course.
Because David Lammy got that mandate from David Cameron recently. Yes. Is that carrying through now?
That's it has to carry through.
I mean, fantastic.
Not only must it carry through, yes. and I would say add to be added to,
yes.
but that, if you like, that review yes. of how the system, how the structural inequality
yes.
affects black people has to be right across, right up. Not just in the criminal justice system where right. it's at the sharp end. You know, me and you can be walking down the streets dressed in suits as we are
yes,
today,
yes.
and still too often, Silvan, be perceived as criminals.
Right.
So because we're in suits, they'll think we're drug dealers
yes.
and we are how
did you get the suit?
Correct. That we used our ill-gotten gains yes. to buy nice suits.
Yes.
Not that we're upstanding members of the community trying to serve our society yeah. in a positive way.
Now I'm going to come back to you at the end to talk about OBV yeah. and the way how that can work towards getting more of us, black persons, involved
critically
in
important.
The model of parliament, of course.
Yeah.
Now, after the coronation, yes. we had the appointment of the cabinet.
Correct.
With Boris Johnson, of course.
Yes.
But before we talked into Boris Johnson, yeah. what do you think of the diversity? Because I've been
yes.
as involved in the political system, people right. are challenging and say, well, Silburn, where are the black cabinet members? She's not very diverse. What do you say about that? I mean, the figure is there.
Yes, no, I mean, there are two Asian women in the cabinet.
Okay.
And I think, an Asian man and an Asian woman.
Priti Patel
and Sajid Javid.
Sajid Javid, coming
which I applaud.
Yes.
But I would like to see an African there too.
Yes.
That would also send a statement of intent. Yes. I expect a number of African people of African descent
yes.
to be made ministers.
This is the junior ministers now, not the cabinet level.
Not the cabinet level.
Right.
I do expect some Africans to be made ministers
yes.
in the week or so. I mean, okay. some people to watch out for, I would say,
yes.
is Helen Grant,
yes.
MP.
But she was former...
She was a former equality minister
equalities
and sports minister.
Right. Uh-huh.
Sam Gimiai was... He was David Cameron's bagman, if
yes.
you like, when he travelled the world.
And he was
also a minister.
Education, recently, yes.
Education.
Yes.
And Kwasi...
Kwarteng.
Kwarteng, yes, yes, yes. Of course, never been a minister before.
Yes.
Very, very bright.
Yes.
You know, very, a sharp tool mm-hmm. in the box. But you look, yes, we want talented black faces mm-hmm. in high places. Critical. But we want those black faces to talk about...
Black issues.
Black issues.
Well, one time, an MP said to me one time, I wish some black MPs
yeah.
would do black.
Correct.
And it is really saying, just deal with some of those issues that we can't really deal with,
you know,
but that you can confront it.
You know, I understand sometimes
yes.
in this building behind
yes.
us, is that they say to our black politicians,
yes.
look, we don't want you to be a one dynamic.
Yes.
So often our black politicians have to choose
yes.
between being a one horse, one trick pony,
yes.
just talking about race, or a multifaceted MP mm-hmm. at the expense of talking about race.
Yes.
We're saying to Theresa May and anyone that will listen, mm-hmm. we can do both.
Yes.
We can talk about race equality, but we can talk about the environment.
As
we
well.
Can talk about the City of London.
Yes.
We can talk about education. Give us the space to yes. be multifaceted.
We can talk about climate change as
correct.
Well. Anything. Now, that's important. And with Boris Johnson now,
yep.
I mean, many people are laughing
yeah.
and they're showing this comical aspect of it.
Sure.
What's your take on Boris yes. Johnson as a foreign minister?
Yeah.
Well, people thought he was gone and he's back.
Sure. I mean, I don't think that's a good idea. It's
yeah.
my own view.
Yeah.
Not least because on the world stage,
mm.
you have to have the gravitas. And I just think that in many ways, the EU debate was so toxic, and he often said a lot of disparaging things to foreign leaders, not least Barack Obama, who we questioned his relationship with the UK because of his African
ancestry.
I hope that Boris Johnson, as the nation's, our representative abroad, has some humility and apologises.
Yes.
Because you cannot go abroad representing the country and you've said these such inappropriate things about so many people.
Yes. Now, that's important. And as we go into the Brexit factor now, one of the things that Boris said and Nigel Farage said were things like, we want to establish better working relationship with the Commonwealth, i.e. Caribbean, i.e. Jamaica.
Sure.
Boris also talked about illegal amnesty to illegal citizens, persons in the UK.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, how do we then, as a black community, challenge those words, those rhetorics? Was it just for gaining votes?
Well, I sadly believe that it was wholly and solely to trick people into Brexit, because this building behind us could have had a better relationship with the Caribbean, with Africa, any time in its parliament.
Mm-hmm.
There was no restrictions on unlocking business tariffs that penalise our community. In fact, as you know, Simon, we had to fight to repel the airport tax that was disproportionate
to the Caribbean. Yes.
And so, of course, Boris Johnson and Nigel Farage said, we want to open our doors to more Commonwealth citizens. Mm-hmm. I don't believe it for a second.
Right. Now, how do we then challenge them? We got to challenge them on this, Simon. Mm. I mean, how do we challenge them on those rhetorics, on those words? You know, like in the Bible, God says, use my words back.
Correct. Hold them to account.
Hold them to account.
Well, I do think we can hold Boris Johnson to account, because he's the foreign secretary.
Yes.
You know, because it's difficult to hold Theresa May to account, because she said, I never said those words.
Yes.
But with Boris Johnson, you said, look, you said you would open the door to trade, to visas,
to
access.
Strengthen the Commonwealth.
To open the doors to the Commonwealth.
Yes.
And so now you have the opportunity. Now we need to hold him to account.
Mm-hmm.
Whether or not it will happen remains to be seen.
Right. Black Lives Matter now. We have seen the ripple effect in the UK.
Right.
And there are people sometimes say, we did not make a lot of noise as though in the States. Now, how does the UK engage with that? Well, where are we at now?
I think Black Britain has been absolutely fantastic in showing its solidarity to the Black Lives Matter movement across the States.
Mm-hmm.
Very big events in Manchester and London. Thousands took to the streets, lobbied the US Embassy here.
Yes.
In London.
Yes.
And of course, those issues around Black Lives Matter parallels what occurs here.
Yes.
I would argue the reason why not more Black Britons are not killed at the hands of the police is because, thankfully, our police officers don't routinely carry guns.
Yes, yes.
But interaction, as Theresa May and David Cameron before have said, with the police, is not acceptable.
Yes.
To be seen as less than, to be seen as a potential criminal, and then that spirals into the fall within the criminal justice system, is not acceptable.
Yes.
We stand in solidarity.
Mm-hmm.
We lament, our heart weeps for those that have lost their lives for no other reason, so we need to remember this, than the colour of their skin.
Definitely. And of course, the best way that the UK can actually show solidarity with even us, I mean, you got the Riggs factor, the Duggan factor here as well.
Exactly. And many more. So there is a parallel.
There's a parallel.
And we are showing solidarity.
Right. Now, Operation Black Vote. Yep. Now, I've been a product
recipient
of Operation Black Vote. And ladies and gentlemen, correct, Simon Woolley was one of those persons. When I was late with my application, he said, listen, man, just get it in, man. I'll wait for you. I thank you for that. Now,
welcome,
Operation
man.
Black Vote, tell us about how that can work.
Well, look, this is very fitting because as we speak today, it is our 20th anniversary.
Wow. Today?
Yesterday.
Yesterday. Awesome.
The 16th of July, 1996, was the across the road there was where we were born. We launched there. A 20-year project. Our goal was to ensure people like you were able to fulfill your ambitions. When we started, there were four black and minority ethnic MPs.
Yes.
Now there are over 40.
Mm-hmm.
We have ministers.
Yes.
We have a fantastic young black mayor, yeah. Marvin Rees.
Marvin, yeah, who was part of my batch as well. Yes.
Was part of your alumni.
Yes. Yes. In Bristol. Yes.
Clive Lewis, new yes. MP too. Yes. So yes, I'm very proud. Of course.
And I must say that my first time speaking over there was when I at the graduation.
At the graduation.
And Simon Woolley was the person who introduced me to David Cameron.
Correct.
At the CCHQ.
That's right.
And I remember David, you said to David Cameron, give this man a safe seat.
That's it.
Give this man a safe seat. Now, Simon, that is awesome. Because of that, it has given me that
emboldened.
Because Dominic Grieve was my mentor.
Correct.
Peter Bottomley.
That's right.
Right? And these are great guys. Yeah, but as a community now, because as someone said to me, Silburn, I will not vote for. Where are the diversity? And I said, would you encourage me to continue? And they said, no. How do you challenge our people now?
Of course, it fills me with great pride to see people like you and Marvin Rees, Clive Lewis, Helen Grant, all come through and become successful.
Yes.
But I want us to be the NAACP of the UK.
Yes.
To have huge amounts of resources so we can fight racism, so we can nurture talent, so we can hold this place to account to serve us. Mm-hmm. That cannot happen without your viewers, without the black community rolling up their sleeves and saying, how can I help?
Right. So final word for OBV and tell us about OBV.
After 20 years of struggle and of really seeking to motivate the UK's black community, it's happy birthday to us. Please celebrate that with us, but offer us your support in whichever way you can. Because if we are strong, the black community is strong, and we can begin to, as I've always said, fulfill our great ambition.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Simon Woolley.
Thank you, mate.
Thank you so much
always
for the interview.
Always
and thank
pleasure.
You for that.